This
राजखोना,
conference will now be recorded.
राजखोना इज प्रेजेंटली एसोसिएट डायरेक्टर इन किमजी कुआरजी एंड कंपनी एलपी. ही वाज प्रीवियसली वर्किंग विद लक्ष्मी शेषन एलएलपी. ही इज द यंग स्पीकर इन आवर कम्युनिटी इन जीएसटी. ही हैज लेड वेरियस topics on GST in BCAG, BCAC, yes, sorry. And he has been awarded as a young presenter in ICAI conference in Hyderabad. Now the dais is with Raj. Raj, you can continue now.
First of all, good evening to everyone who has joined the webinar. At the outset, I would like to thank the association for giving me this opportunity to conduct this webinar on the very important topic and very close to everyone's heart, especially in the current times, which is GST. So there are a lot of developments in GST which are taking place day in and day out, and so this webinar was thought of, and currently everyone is in this lockdown stage, and what will happen with respect to GST needs to be analyzed. What are the relaxations given, and there are certain developments which have taken place in this interim period with regard to the export related matters, refund related issues, etc. So this is a webinar which is rightly been conducted by the association, and I hope that all of us will be able to get some insights in this session. I will also try to cover whatever the recent changes are there during this discussion. Before I start the session, I would request everyone to keep their mics and cameras off, and also in case you have any queries related to the topic, you can post it in the chat box. I'll be pleased to take those queries at the end of the session. So we have around 1.5 hours time. So I have divided the presentation basically into three parts. One is regarding the recent relaxations which are given with respect to the relaxation in the GST compliances. Secondly, there are certain important announcements, notifications, circulars which are being issued in the past 3-4 months. Important circulars and notifications I would be taking. And there are certain judgments also which are important, and which was creating a nuisance in and which are being talked about in the social media, etc. So we'll be covering those things also. So three areas I'll be covering. At the end, I'll take a question answer session also. So broadly, this is the outline of today's session. Before I start the session, some disclaimers also I would like to give is that whatever views I'm expressing is existing today, because GST is an ever-changing law, and notifications are issued day in and day out. During the course of my discussion also, there might be some officer who might be issuing a notification because the lockdown has been extended, and therefore certain due dates which had already been prescribed, they might get extended. So it is possible that after this session there might be some changes in the due dates also, which are very much certain according to me. So therefore, whoever has joined the session, kindly note that whatever I am expressing is whatever is existing as on date. So if any changes are happening in future, then we might please refer to those notifications, etc. First part of the session, basically, I'll be covering the relaxation in the GST compliances on account of this coronavirus outbreak. Basically, when we are talking about the relaxations, broadly, the relaxations would be related to the extension of the due dates. That is the major thing which this section I'll be speaking about. Whatever due dates for the compliances has been increased. So that is the first broad topic I'll be covering. Secondly, there are certain relaxations with regard to the ITC mismatch, ITC rule 36.4, that is the blocking of the credits which they had done, restricting the credits to 110% of the credit which is appearing in the 2A. So that relaxation is also there. So first I will take up the relaxations which are related to the composition taxpayers. So composition taxpayers, the relaxations are four relaxations have been given broadly. One is regarding if you want to opt for a composition scheme, then there is a form CMP02 which you have to file for the financial year 2021. So the due date for filing is that you have to, before the financial year starts, you have to file this form that I want to opt from the composition scheme. So if you are a regular taxpayer and you want to convert to a composition taxpayer, then you have to file this form. So the due date for that was 31st of March 2020. It has been extended to 30th of June 2020. Once you opt for the composition scheme, then whatever credit is print of ITC of inputs held in stock, inputs containing finished goods, etc., is lying in your stock, then that ITC, relevant ITC, has to be reversed. For that, the due date for reversal of that ITC was 30th of May. So basically, you have to reverse that within 60 days from the end of the financial year. That form ITC03 has to be filed. So that also has been extended to 31st of July 2020. Then the composition taxpayers are now required to file quarterly payment, make the quarterly payments. Basically, monthly payments have to be made in form CMP08. And file the returns in annual return. Only one return has to be filed now for composition taxpayers. So this return, one return has to be filed. So the monthly payments for this quarterly Q4 was 18th of April 2020. That has been extended to 7th of July 2020. And GSTR for the furnishing of GST returns was for financial year 19-20 was 30th April. That has been extended to 15th of June. July, 15th of July. So this is for the composition taxpayer. So composition taxpayers, all the due dates have been extended. Now, when I'm talking about the normal taxpayers, the two kind of compliance they are doing is filing of GSTR1 and GSTR3B. That is the returns, and the payment has to be done by with the 3B. So there is no extension of the due date. Basically, there none of the due dates for the month of March, April, and May have been February, March, and April. All this during the lockdown period, whatever credit returns were being to be filed, none of the due dates have been extended. Only the relaxation which is being given is with regard to the interest and the late fee. So the due dates of filing of the returns of GSTR1 and GSTR3B, none of these due dates have been extended. So for GSTR1, basically there are two kinds of taxpayers. They have divided the category into two kinds. One is below 1.5 CR and more than 1.5 CR, up to 1.5 CR, more than 1.5 CR. So more than 1.5 CR, the taxpayers have to file the returns on a monthly basis. GSTR1 has to be filed on a monthly basis. If your aggregate turnover in the previous financial year is more than 1.5 CR. So here aggregate turnover has to be seen. Aggregate turnover means turnover at a PAN level. And the preceding financial year, so in the preceding financial year, you have to see. So that they have said that if for the month of March, the due date was 11th of April. So they have said if you file by 30th of June 2020, then there will be no late fee. Similarly, for April, 11th of May was the due date. So all these three, April, March, April, and May, 11th of the next month was a due date. They have said that if you file by 30th of June, then in that case, the late fees will be waived off. this is for the first categories. Now here you have to see, for when you are seeing the return for the month of this March, then you have to see the turnover of the financial year 18-19, and if you are seeing for the returns of the period of April, then you have to see the turnover of 19. So that turnover calculation has to be done, and aggregate turnover as per the GST turnover has to be seen, not the turnover as per the books, because aggregate turnover includes all the exempt supplies, stock transfer, etc. All this, this has to be taken into consideration when you are computing the aggregate turnover. Similarly, if your registered taxpayer having an aggregate turnover up to 1.5 CR, then January to March, the due date was 30th of April. That has been again extended to 30th of June. And April to June, the due date remains same, that due date has not been extended. So 31st of July 2020, that is remains the same. There is no extension with regard to that due date, because they assume that after 30th of June, there will be no requirement to extend the due dates. We are fighting a war, and mostly all the chartered accountants, in the month of June, they will be fighting a war, June ki jung, because all the due dates, GST, income tax, etc., will be in June. And it will be like whatever sleep or whatever rest we have taken in this 1 or 1.5 months, all that will get drawn away, and whatever rest we have taken, that will everything in June, all that whatever relaxations or whatever rest we have taken, all that will be put to work. So June will be very very what we say, very difficult month for all the practitioners, all the companies also, because a lot of other due dates are also there. So therefore June month will be very crucial for everyone. This was for regarding GSTR 1. GSTR 3B also, they have extended the lot of due dates. Basically, they have divided the taxpayers into three categories. One is up to 1.5 CR, 1.5 CR, more than 1.5 CR, and up to 5 crores, and more than 5 crores. So three categories they have divided. So for the first two categories, that is up to 1.5 CR and up to 1.5 to 5 CR, the second category, the due dates were basically staggered depending upon the state. So from, I think, this financial year, they have started the staggering of the due dates for the 3B. Since the portal had a lot of load, and it was not able to take so much load on the last dates, therefore they have staggered the filing of the 3B, GSTR 3B, based on the state. So if you have particular southern states, then the due date is 22nd, and in the northern states 24th. So they have divided India in such a way that all the states in the lower part of the map, that is 22nd, and the upper part of the map 24. So that way they had divided the due dates for up to 5 CR turnover taxpayers. So the first two categories, the due date remains the same. However, interest and penalty has been waived off. So whatever interest on, if you file the return on a delayed filing of the return, or as well as the payment or the late fee on that, 20 rupees and 50 rupees per day, whatever that penalty was. So that has been waived off if you file the return within the due date prescribed. So February return, if you file by 30th of June, March return by 3rd of July, April return by 6th of July. So this is for the taxpayers having aggregate turnover up to 1.5 CR in the preceding financial. So that relaxation they have given. But if you don't file the return within the time limit prescribed, that is the relaxation period prescribed, then interest and penalty will apply. So that needs to be seen. So if you are a taxpayer up to 1.5 CR, means your client is a taxpayer having aggregate turnover up to 1.5 CR in the preceding financial year, then February return has to be filed by 30th of June. If it is filed on 1st of July, then interest and late fee will apply from the due date, that is 22nd of March. So that needs to be taken care. And there are staggered filing for February, March, and April for this kind of taxpayers. Second category is more than 1.5 CR and up to 5 crores. So in that also, they have waived off the interest and penalty, basically, but subject to you file the return within the time limits prescribed. So for Feb, the due return has to be furnished by 29th of June. For March, it has to be furnished by 29th of June. But for April, they have said 30th of June. So that 29 and 30 days is important for taxpayers more than 1.5 year and up to 5 years. So irrespective of when you file the return during this period from 22nd March till 30th June, no interest and penalty. If you file on the 30th or for the February and March and April on 1st July, then interest will apply from the first date. That is whatever is the due date for that particular period. From that date, the interest and penalty will apply. So that it is crucial that you file all the returns on time, especially with the 3B. Now, something very interesting with regard to the taxpayers whose turnover, aggregate turnover in the preceding financial year is more than 5 crores. So in this, what they have done, that the due dates remain the same. However, if you are filing the returns, so relaxation period for interest they have given. If you are filing the return within 15 days of the original due date. So if for the month of February, the due date was 20th of March. Then 15 days relaxation period they have given. That is, if you file the return between 21st of March till 4th of May, 4th of April, then there won't be any interest. If you file the return from the 16th day till the relaxation period ends, that is, relaxation period ends on 24th of June. So if you file the return between that period, then interest at the rate of 9% will apply only for that period. That is from 5th of March till the actual date, whenever you actual date of filing, whenever you file the return. So only for that period interest has to be calculated. However, if you miss the bus, that if you file the return after 24th of June 2020, then in that case interest will be applied from the first date, that is the 21st of March till the actual date of filing. So here the interest of the concessional rate of interest of 18% 9% will not be available, 18% has to be paid. So again, filing of returns during the relaxation period, 15 days free interest free period. The next from the 16th day till the relaxation period ends, that is till 24th of June, 9% interest, and thereafter 18% interest. But 18% interest will be calculated from the first day. So this is very crucial that you file the returns within the deadlines. Now, many of you have my similarly for March also, that similar thing will be there that I have summarized in this table. First 15 days, no interest, then 9% up to the relaxation period ends. And then if you don't file within that relaxation period, then 18%. If you file all the returns by 24th June 2020, then no late fee will be there. However, that late fee waiver also, if you file the return after the relaxation period ends, then late fee will be calculated from the first date. So that is important that you file all the returns within the time limit prescribed. Now, a lot of you might have questions that the lockdown will end on 3rd of May. So whether it will be possible for everyone to file the returns basically for the month of March. So I think that the government, when they issued these notifications, they had considered that a lockdown will end on 14th of April. However, there is a possibility that they might increase this interest relaxation period for some more time. Therefore, we might expect a notification for the month of April, at least March, for the month of March, extending the interest-free period for some 1 week or 10 days, whatever the case, depending on how they plan to end the lockdown. This was regarding the taxpayers whose turnover is up to more than 5 crores. Now, the question which arises here is whether the benefit of interest waiver and concessional rate of interest shall be availed, shall be available if the GST paid during the relaxation period pertains to transaction of the tax period prior to February. So suppose you are filing the return for the month of March and you are reporting certain transactions which are related to June. So certain invoices you have missed out, you have not paid the tax, the invoices are dated January. You are reporting those invoices in the return for the month of March. So there is a delay in payment of tax for the month of January and you are reporting the same in the month of March. So whether you can avail the relaxation, that is the concessional rate of interest or the waiver of interest, according to me, this waiver is only for the transactions which are effected during the period, that is February, March and April. If the transactions are pertaining to any period prior to this, then in that case, the concessional rate or the waiver of interest will not be available. So that needs to be seen, that if you are reporting certain transactions which are related to the prior period, that is from before February, March or April, whatever return you are filing, then in that case, the concessional rate of interest will not be applicable. Also, if in the month of March you are reporting something of February, then in that case also you have to see that these transactions are related to February, then that period of the February needs to be seen. So it is very crucial that you segregate all these transactions when you are reporting in the 3B, and when you are auditing also, as an auditor also, you need to see that how this interest waiver has been taken. People report February transactions in March. GSTR1, they file late, so they might report that transactions in the respective months. But in 3B, it is possible that February related transactions are reported in March, March related transactions in April. So in this case, it is very crucial to note that the interest waiver will be only related to those, the liability which arises in that month. If liability arises in the previous month, then the interest waiver needs to be seen on a case-to-case basis. This is something very crucial everyone should see. This will apply to this kind of taxpayers, also other two categories of taxpayers also, which I have discussed. Now, this is one example which the circular, there is a circular issued by the government, 136 of 09-2020. In this, they have given an example, taken a particular month and how this interest will be calculated. So they have said that if for the month of, this example is for the month of March, the due date was 20th of April 2020. For taxpayers more than 5 years, they have taken. If you file the 3B on 2nd of May, then there is a delay of 11 days. So whether the condition for reduced interest is fulfilled, yes, answer zero interest. So if you file within 15 days, there is no interest. Then on 20th of May, you are filing, suppose 30 days delay is there. So in this case, again, the condition of relaxation has been given, but interest for the first 15 days will be nil, and for the remaining period, 9% per annum. So that needs to be calculated. If you file on 20th of June, 61 days. So first 15 days, zero interest, and the remaining period, that is the 46 days, you will have to pay the interest at the rate of 9%. If you file the return on 24th of June, then 65 days are there, total delay. So in this case, again, because the relaxation period ends on 24th of June. So for the first 15 days, interest rate will be zero. And after the after the 15 days, the interest rate will be 9%. That is, for 50 days, will pay interest at the rate of 9%. And if you file on 30th of June, which is after the relaxation period ends, then there is a delay of 71 days. However, the relaxation of the reduced interest will not be available, as well as late fees also will not be available. So in this case, you have to pay interest at the rate of 18% for 71 days, and no benefit of the reduced interest. And late fee also, relaxation, whatever late fees is payable for the delayed filing of 3B, that also needs to be. This is, they have clarified in the circular 136. I have just shared that example with you. Now, the relaxation which we discussed was only regarding the 3Bs, which we discussed was only regarding February, March and April. For the month of May also, they have given relaxation, they have extended the due date. Now, in this case, they have not given the relaxation of interest, etc. They have extended the due date. So, if the turnover is more than 5 crores in the preceding financial year, that the due date has been extended from 20th of June to 27th of June. If the turnover up to 5 crores in the states mentioned, then it is extended from 22nd June to 12th of July. And for the other states, more than up to 5 crores, 24th June to 14th of July. So that extension is there from time to time, so that extension is available. So therefore, for the month of May, the due date has been extended. There is no relaxation in respect of interest or anything. The due date only is an extension. Therefore, important that for the month of May, you file the returns in time. Now, various other due dates have been extended also. Basically, whatever department has to do, like completion of any proceedings, passing of any order, sanctioning or approval, etc. So for that, if the due date for that work they had to do falls between from the period 20th of March to 29th of June, that has been extended to 30th of June. So that whatever department has to do from their side, it has been extended. With regard to the assessees also, if they are required to file any reply, they have to file any appeal, they have to furnish any report, document, etc. So that also, that due date, if that due date falls between the period 20th of March to 29th of June, then in that case it has been extended to 30th of June. So that also has been extended. The returns, there are other returns also, like the return for the non-resident taxable person, or the ISD return, or the TDS TCS returns. So those returns also, they are not specifically mentioned, but this in this notification they have issued, notification number, I think it is notification number 35. In that they have said that this will also apply to them, and therefore these due dates have been extended for the non-resident taxable person, ISD, TDS, TCS, etc. That due date has been extended. So for the month of February, March, etc., whatever the due date was, if they fall between 20th of March till 29th of June, that due date get extended to 30th of June. Now, a lot of people have questioned that whether the extension of time limit will apply for filing of the application for letter of undertaking, basically the exporters, for making the export on payment of, on without payment of GST under LUT. So in this case, it will equally apply. They have clarified by way of the circular 137 that the time limit for filing of LUT for the month of, for the year 2020 shall stand extended to 30th of June 2020. In this case, the taxpayers may quote the reference number of the LUT for the financial year. So whatever exports you are making during this period of the 3 months, you have to quote the LUT number of the preceding financial year. Whatever the LUT number was there, that needs to be quoted. So that they have clarified. However, the extension of the time limit will not apply in the following cases. Basically, the time of supply, then registration requirements, casual taxable person registration requirement, time limit for issuance of invoice, due dates, that GSTR 1-3B due dates have not been extended. If interest, etc. is there, then unless that is specified, then only that waiver is given. So all these cases which have been mentioned on the slide, the extension is not available. If there are certain compliances with regard to this kind of provisions, then the due date has not been extended. So relief is not available for this kind of compliance. Important part which everyone was concerned with regard to the ITC relaxation has been given for this also. From October 2019, the ITC was restricted to the IT 110% of the ITC which appears in the GSTR 2A. So up to that only you could take. So that they have relaxed. So if this condition of taking ITC needs to be fulfilled cumulatively for the months from February till August, all this needs to be fulfilled cumulatively. And if there is any non-compliance with regard to this month, then in the month of September, the reversal has to be done. I'll take an example. So for the period February to August, the eligible ITC as per books is 1 lakh. The ITC reflected in GSTR 2A is 80,000. So this is as on September when I am filing the return for September. ITC claimed in 3B till August is 1 lakh, because I will be taking ITC as per the books, because this relaxation is given. Now in the month of September, I have to reverse the ITC as per the books. So what will be that 80,000 into 110%, so 88,000, the remaining has to be reversed. So that 12,000 will be reversed in the month of September. Now the question arises whether interest to be paid on the ITC reverse in the month of September. According to me, if you are reversing the ITC in the month of September, because this is a relaxation demand, and they have specifically said that the cumulative adjustment has to be done in the month of September. So therefore, according to me, if you do the adjustment in the month of September, you reverse the ITC for this period, and that has been done in the month of September, then in that case, I don't think any interest will be applicable because that relaxation has been given. And therefore, if you reverse the ITC, whatever has to be reversed as per this rule, cumulatively for from February to August, then interest will not apply, provided you do this in the month of September for the 3B of September. If you do it in the 3B of October, then in that case, the interest will apply. And that will apply from what period? According to me, it will apply from the due date of September, because that condition had to be fulfilled in the due date by the September. So that interest will apply from that period. But this is again a little bit tricky question. But according to me, what view I feel is that till September, if you comply with this or you reverse the month of September, then no interest. And if you don't do reverse it and you reverse in the subsequent months, then interest will apply from September, due date of September. So that that according to me, this view can be taken. But we need to see what the government is. They might come out with some clarification, etc. But as the section reads, according to me, it will apply from September. If you reverse by September, then no interest. And if reversal is done in subsequent months, from September, that interest is to be. One more extension relaxation they have given with regard to e-way bills. So as you are aware, that e-way bill is valid based on the distance, basically some distance which has been mentioned. One day to 10 days, etc. That relaxation is given. Validity of the e-way bill is there based on the distance between the buyer and the seller. So basically, if they have given a relaxation that if the validity period is expiring between the period 20th March till 15th of April, then that will be extended till 30th of April. I see that further extension on this because the lockdown has been extended till 3rd of May. There might be further extension on this. So e-way bill validity has been extended. The validity falls between 20th of March to 15th of April, and that will get extended until the 30th of April. So that it was deemed to be extended. But now further extension is possible, and they might cover a further period also. They might cover a further period also, and also the further extension of the period. So in e-way bill, this relaxation is. This was basically more on the GST front, whatever the relaxations are given. In FTP also, they have extended the FTP by 1 year. So the FTP will remain for one more year. So that relaxation is also done. Continue current FTP policy that from 2015-2020, that will continue for one more financial year. A lot of relaxations are given with regard to advance license, CTC license, etc. Fulfillment of this condition, export obligation, etc. A lot of relaxations are being done. I'm not covering those because that might take a lot of time. We have only covered a lot of topics in this short webinar. So this was on the relaxations in the first 30-40 minutes. I've covered this. The next 20-25 minutes, I will cover the important notifications basically with regard to the exporters, etc., and the refund also. First is the general one with regard to the GST audit and annual return. So the due date for the GST audit and annual return basically for 17-18 was extended in January. For 18-19, that prescribed the January 2020, so two years basically. I think 18 till 20, more than one year, etc. It was extended. But 18 also extended by 3 months, and now they have extended again by 3 months. So for financial year 18-19, the due date is for 9 and 9C is 30th of June 2020. So that extension is given. Now, with regard to the relaxation with furnishing of the reconciliation statement, so in the council, the previous council meeting, with regard to the 9C for financial 18-19, what they have given the relaxation is that if your aggregate turnover is up to 5 crores, then you are not required to file the annual. Reconciliation statement. So, audit has to be done only for the taxpayers whose aggregate turnover in the financial 18-19. Is more than 5 CR. So up to 5 CR is not required. So this is what I have summarized, that up to 2 crores annual return is optional. reconciliation statement is not required. More than 2 crores up to 5 crores mandatory annual return, but reconciliation statement is not required. And more than 5 crores both are mandatory. So this is with regard to the GST audit and annual return. Notification 16 issued. Now, very interesting point with regard to the refund. Basically, refund of the accumulated ITC on export of goods which are made under LUT. So, you are normally there is a formula for taking the refund, ITC refund of the ITC. It is the whatever is the turnover of the export zero-rated goods upon the adjusted total turnover into the net ITC. That formula was prescribed, and the refund can be taken based on. Now, this is something only applicable for the export of goods, not export of services. What the amendment has been. So, this is the formula. Basically, if you see the formula, total turnover of the zero-rated supply of goods, the zero-rated supply of services divided by the adjusted total turnover into the net ITC. That is the formula basically. Now, this definition of the zero-rated turnover of zero-rated supply of goods, they have amended that definition. And in this definition, what they have done is that you take the value of the zero-rated supply, whatever you are showing as an export in your turnover of the goods, etc. And they have now inserted a word that whatever is the turnover of the value, whatever is the value of the like goods which are domestically supplied by the same supplier or a similar place supplier as declared by the supplier. So in this valuation has to be done. So whatever value you are taking, for you are a supplier, you are making export supply as well as you are making some domestic supply of the similar goods, then that value 1.5% of that value needs to be taken, and then compare with your actual export value. Whichever is lower, that will be the turnover for the purpose of the calculation of this refund amount. So now this is a very draconic amendment, because you can government is asking the exporters to do a kind of transfer pricing for all the refund application they are doing. So whenever they export any goods, they have to calculate the transfer price of that goods, basically to calculate the value of the similarly supplied goods, or similar, if you are not supplying the similarly supplied goods, then you are doing some other thing. So basically this is something very unique they are doing, and I think this was issued on 23rd of March. Everyone was busy in the Janta curfew, banging their thalis and making noise, clapping hands. And some officer was drafting this notification, and they drafted such a notification for the exporters. This is a industry which has been badly hit, and by putting certain such kind of restrictions, they are discouraging exports basically. We understand that there are some kind of exporters who are doing malpractice, that they are artificially increasing the value of the goods, and therefore artificially increasing the value of the goods and claiming higher refunds. But that proportion is very small, and applying this to all the taxpayers who are genuine exporters, it will be very difficult for them to comply with this condition, especially where there are a lot of compliances already they are doing as an exporter. So now I am just given this example for how this is impacting. Suppose there is only one product, a dealer is dealing in only one product A. He has an export turnover. Suppose he is supplying 100 quantities of that product A for price of 200 rupees. So 2 lakhs is the value. Domestically, he is supplying the same quantity product at 100 rupees, say. So 1 lakh rupees is the value. Turnover is 3 lakh rupees. ITC is 50,000. Now, how much refund of the ITC will be available in this case? Is ITC go by the old method, then in that case 50,000 into 2 lakhs upon 3 lakhs, so 33,000 ITC was available. But now if you go by the new method, the value of the remunerated supply of goods will be 1.5 into 1000, that is a quantity, and the price will be of the domestically supplied goods, which is 100 rupees or 2 lakhs, whichever is lower. So that is 1.5 lakhs. Therefore, this will reduce the refund claim of all the exporters who are exporting under LUT without payment of GST. This is very important, amendment. And all our clients who are dealing in this export or making export of goods under LUT, they'll be getting impacted because of this amendment. And they have done this amendment in the month of March. So this will apply for the future period only, not from the past period. But still, it is a very important amendment. There is no change in the mechanism for the refund for export of goods and payment of IGST. So if you are paying IGST and then claiming refund, there is no change in the refund mechanism, calculation mechanism. Also, export of services, there is no change. This is only for export of goods. But this is a very important change and a draconic change according to me. And this will be certainly litigated in the high courts. And a lot of companies would file a writ petition in this regard, that you cannot equate the fraudulent exporters with the normal exporters or genuine exporters. And if an exporter is, exporter is only in this export business, he does not have any domestic supply, then they will have to find out the value of the goods from the other suppliers. Now, whether what is the like kind, similar quantity or quality of the supply, so that again will be disputed. So therefore, this is a good opportunity I see for the professionals, because a lot of opportunities have been taken away, especially the GST audit for 18-19 from 2 crores to 5 crores, that has been taken away. So this is a good opportunity for us, wherein we can explore something with regard to the export refunds, etc. But still, from a point of view of business, this is a very draconic change. From the professionals, I feel it will be a boon for us because we'll have to guide them in all this. So this is a good change for the professionals opportunity, but businessman is impacted draconically. I feel this will have a draconic impact because a lot of ITC is stuck. The refunds are not being given, especially the ITC related refunds. And now imposing such conditions, they are doing creating a mess in the export sector. Now, one more regarding the refund for the exporters is the realization of the export proceeds, basically for the export of goods. Export of services, as you are aware, that export of services, you have to realize the consideration in the convertible foreign exchange. And the time limit for that was 1 year from the whenever you are exporting the services. Within 1 year, you have to realize the foreign exchange export proceeds in case of services. There was no condition similar to for the case of export of goods. So therefore, they have inserted one rule 96B, through which now the exporters will also have to fulfill this condition of realizing the sales proceeds in convertible foreign exchange. Then only the refund will be final. So basically, that is not a precondition. It is not a precondition for making an export refund claim. In services, it is a precondition that you have to show that you have received the sales proceed in convertible foreign exchange. And then only they basically sanction the refund. But in the goods, what they have said is that if the sale proceeds in respect of the export of goods has not been realized in full or part in India within a period allowed under the FEMA, including any extension thereof, the person to whom the refund has been made shall deposit the amount so refunded to the extent of the non-realization within period of 30 days from along with interest. So as per FEMA, the time limit I think is 1 year. And if within 1 year, if you are not realizing the amount for the goods or some extension is given by the RBI, then in that case, you have to reverse the refund, whatever you have got. So refund, you can apply for refund before that, but you have to realize within the time limit which is prescribed under FEMA laws, FEMA regulations basically. If the RBI allows you to write off as per the FEMA law that write off is available, then then the interest will not, the refund will not be recovered if RBI allows. So everything depends on whatever the time limit or the indexation with the RBI gives in regard to this export proceeds. So within the time limit prescribed under the FEMA laws, you have to realize the amount and then your refund will be final. You will get a refund on a provisional basis, but it will be final based on the realization of export proceeds in convertible foreign exchange as per the FEMA laws. They have not mentioned the word convertible foreign exchange. They have said as per the FEMA laws. That can be whatever FEMA laws say that it has to be realizing convertible foreign exchange. So everything depends on FEMA laws. Suppose you did not realize within the time limit prescribed, and therefore you have to deposit the refund along with interest. Now, in subsequently you realize those amount in sales proceeds, then you can apply for the refund. That refund you have to give the evidence that you have received the amount, and then refund the amount. The refund of only tax is given. Refund of interest, whether they will give or not, that needs to be seen. So that is important. That within 3 months you have to give the evidence to the government that we have realized, and therefore you pay back the refund which we have deposited. So that is important. This is also very important amendment, especially for the exporters of goods. For services, this was there. Now for goods also, they have brought in this condition. And very crucial, very important amendment which they have brought in for the exporters of goods. So this was the second part of the discussion, which was regarding the exporters, the GST audit, etc. Now there are 2-3 important judgments which I would like to highlight, which were creating a nuisance value or some advance rulings also. So one is regarding the interest, interest on gross liability and net liability. So that is the first thing I like to cover. Second is on the director remuneration. Lot of discussion is happening in social media whether GST is applicable on director remuneration under reverse charge, etc. And third is regarding the ocean freight. There is a judgment of the Gujarat High Court in Weight Minerals regarding ocean freight. So three judgments I will be discussing in this. And after that, I will be discussing on the emerging issues and challenges. There are a lot of, once this lockdown ends, lot of emerging issues and challenges will be there, especially in the GST, and what as a professional or advisors or consultants we should bear in mind or be ready while we discussing that. So first is Mega Engineering. The judgment was there given by the Telangana High Court. It said that because there is a delay in payment of tax, then interest has to be calculated on the gross tax liability. Suppose the total output liability is 100 and ITC is 50, so I pay in cash 50 rupees. So normally the interest under the old regime, especially the VAT service, etc., interest was paid only on the cash component. This judgment said that interest has to be paid on the gross amount. It is 100 rupees and not the 50 rupees which is paid in cash. Therefore, departments, all the department officers, they started, they took the benefit of this. Thereafter, one amendment was made in the Section 50 in the Finance Act 2019, wherein they said that the interest will apply only on the net tax liability, whatever they paid in cash through the electronic cash ledger, only on that component interest will be applied. However, this amendment was not given retrospective effect. There was no retrospective effect given to this amendment section. So departmental officers interpreted in such a way that this will apply only for the from a prospective period. So only after this Finance Act is applicable, this amendment will apply. For the past period, interest has to be paid on the gross. And our finance minister got some information that in the newspaper also it came that around 40,000 crores of interest can be recovered. Every one of us is aware that what is the fiscal deficit position of the country at that time. Budget was coming, and therefore some people in the CBIC thinking that they found that this 40,000 interest can be recovered. Therefore, they started issuing notices to all taxpayers that interest has to be paid. So they computed something from their software and shooting started issuing notices that you pay interest, etc. And lot of discussions happened about whether it will apply retrospective, prospective, etc. Lot of UN guy was there in the industry. Therefore, there was a GST Council meeting. And in that, the discussion was that this amendment for the interest will be effective from the retrospective. It will be applied from 1st of July 2007. So that amendment was brought in. The GST Council recommended that interest for delayed payment in GST is to be charged on the net cash liability, and this will be the retrospective. Now again, this amendment is still not been effective. Only a recommendation has been. But according to me, this proviso, even though it is not specifically mentioned that it is retrospective in the Finance Act, it will have a effect. I think it is a curative. It is a clarificatory amendment, and therefore it will have retrospective effect. And this has been clarified by the council agenda minutes, etc. And therefore, no interest will apply for the past period also. If interest is interest will apply only on the net liability. Now the question comes that if interest is already paid on the gross tax liability, then whether the differential interest, whatever has been paid, whether refund can be taken. According to me, refund can be taken, but this will be subject to unjust enrichment if you have recovered this amount. So that unjust enrichment principle has to be applied. Therefore, refund applications can certainly be made, but this will be subject to the unjust enrichment principle. That so that needs to be seen. This was regarding the interest on delayed payment of GST. This was a burning issue everyone was facing, and there are a lot of challenges, a lot of different situations also in this. But I am just giving a general update on the interest on the delayed payment of tax. There are a lot of situations. This will depend on a case-to-case basis that how this interest is being computed. Basically, suppose I am calculating the interest in the month of especially for the GST audit related payments which we are making, whether interest will apply still. So again, that needs to be seen, because the payment is made now for the financial year 17, 18 or 18, 19, and whether if I'm utilizing the ITC of the current period. Whether that is allowed, there are a lot of disputes on that, a lot of views being taken on that, and whether interest will be applicable. So liability pertains to the earlier period, and the ITC is for the future period. Then when the payment is made on a future date and this ITC is utilized, then whether interest will still apply or not. According to me, it's a very difficult position to take, that ITC is for the other subsequent period and liability relates to the previous period. Then interest, this relaxation will not apply according to me. It's very difficult to take this down. According to me, it will not apply. So this was regarding the interest. This is the first judgment I wanted to share. Second, and again, in this one update in the Mega Engineering, that is also there, that the Telangana High Court, there is a review petition being filed. And that has been accepted, so they are reviewing this judgment. So this judgment, they are subject to review to the Telangana High Court. So, and there are certain writ petitions in the Delhi High Court, etc. In Landmark Lifestyle, something companies there. So they have filed a writ petition in that case also. So that also has been. Second is regarding the director's remuneration. A lot of UN cry and etc. is happening because there is an advance ruling, a recent advance ruling in Claycraft India Private Limited. This advance ruling, normally what happens that these advance ruling people are from the department only, and therefore most of the advance rulings are pro revenue, and some of these people don't understand the intent. Basically, what is the intent of the law? These officers, they are not judicial members, they are employees of the government only, and they are giving advance ruling on all this. So this is something which has created a lot of confusion in the industry as well as the professionals, the professional community. And I would like to put forth my views on this also, that they are saying that the remuneration which is being paid to the director, you have to pay GST and the reverse charge. Now there are different kind of directors a company may have. कंपनी में होल टाइम डायरेक्टर, एग्जीक्यूटिव डायरेक्टर, इंडिपेंडेंट डायरेक्टर एक्सेट्रा. Basically, the directors have to be segregated into two heads. Basically, the director is an employee of the company and director is not an employee. He is a consultant, acting as a consultant basically, and drawing consultancy fees, sitting fees, etc. According to me, whatever, whenever there is an employer-employee relationship, as per Schedule 3 of the CGST entry number 1, services by an employee to employer in the course and furtherance of business is neither supply of goods nor supply of services. Director is an employee of the company, that is, he is a whole time employee of the company, he is on the payrolls of the company, then in that case this reverse charge will not apply. If you read the notification 13 serial number 6, it says services supplied by the director of a company or body corporate is a supplier, and supplier is a director and receiver is a company. So there is a call as supplier recipient relationship. There is no if there is a master servant relationship between the director and the company, then this reverse charge will not apply. It will be covered by Schedule 3. So first thing that needs to be seen is a master servant relationship. If there is a master servant relationship, then it is covered under Schedule 3. Once it is covered under Schedule 3, 6 will not apply. There is no levy, then how reverse charge will apply? Therefore, this will purely apply to the directors who are independent directors or directors who are not employees, who are in the capacity of a consultant. So in those cases, this will apply. This reverse charge will apply. In that case, company will pay. So this advance ruling, it says that on all the directors, whatever remuneration is paid to all the directors, in that case, GST will be applicable under reverse charge. According to me, it is a wrong advance ruling, and this needs to be reconsidered. However, there has been a lot of dispute under the service tax regime also with regard to this, and therefore this advance ruling has came. So therefore, in the service tax regime also this dispute is going on. But there are favorable judgments of the Bombay Tribunal. I have mentioned this Rentworks and Rentworks India Private Limited and allied lenders. In this, they have said that if the director is an employee of the company, the full-time director, not executive of the company, then in that case he is an employee. And therefore, the reverse charge will not apply. It is covered under the employer-employee category. That is, it is covered under Schedule 3. Service tax also similar. This kind of transactions were not considered as a service. So this is regarding the advance ruling on the director's remuneration. The third and most important thing is regarding the ocean freight. Now, basically for import under this EIF basis. Now, what happens that I am in India and I am importing from, I am A in India importing from B in USA. And B in USA is, the contract is on a EIF basis. So, he will be arranging for the transportation freight, etc. All this needs to be done by B. So, he engages a third party in USA for the shipping line in USA. And that shipping line will receive the payment from BNP. So the contract is between the foreign shipping line and the foreign exporter. I am not involved in any sense. So therefore, this is what they have said, that the supplier of service is located in non-taxable territory and the receiver is also located in non-taxable territory. Then in that case, the importer has to pay the tax. So now in this, what was happening that on the freight component, the Indian importer was made liable to pay the tax. Now, Indian importer is not the party to the contract of the transportation of the goods. The contract is between the foreign transporter and the foreign exporter. Indian importer is nowhere concerned in this. Therefore, there is no nexus, basically no contractual obligation between the importer and the foreign shipping line. However, the government said that importer will pay tax under reversal on the freight component. The freight component valuation also they give that 10% of this EIF value, that will be the freight amount, and on that 5% GST has to be paid. Now there is a reverse charge is applicable only on the recipients. If you are a recipient, then specified categories are provided, under that recipient is liable to pay under reverse charge. Now importer, a recipient is also defined under Section 9, subsection 93 of section 2, it says that the recipient is a person who is liable to pay the consideration, who is liable to pay the consideration, who is liable to pay the consideration for the supply of goods. Now, importer or the services, the importer is not liable to pay the consideration for the service which is availed by the foreign export. So that is not the case. So, importer is not a recipient. So therefore, this section is this notification is ultra vires this section. The notification is ultra vires this section and it is unconstitutional. And there was a writ petition filed in Mohit Minerals, wherein the High Court said that this section is ultra vires, this notification is ultra vires this section. Importer is not the recipient, and therefore they struck down this notification. Gujarat High Court gave a favorable judgment. They also relied that there is no contract. Charging section has to be strictly construed. Importer is not the beneficiary. All these grounds they have taken. Also, the ground was that there is dual levy. When I'm importing the goods, I'm paying IGST on the CIF value also. And again, on the service component, I have to pay IGST again as a on the reverse side basis. Therefore, it is dual taxation. So that ground was also taken. Now the first question arises that if I have already paid this IGST on the services and I have claimed the ITC, whether I have to reverse the ITC. According to me, this ITC reversal, whatever ITC reversal has to be, this question is pertaining to a reversal of ITC. According to me, it is this. There are a lot of judgments in the old regime which says that if the tax is wrongly paid and if refund is availed in respect of this wrongly paid tax, it amounts to taking the suo motu credit. So you cannot make a double-edged sword that on output you are saying you pay tax and then you are not on the reverse charge you pay tax and then ITC is also not available. So that cannot happen. So if you have paid the ITC IGST on this ocean freight, then according to me ITC need not be reversed. If the department disputes it, then there are a lot of judgments under the old regime, especially the service tax regime, which says the wrongly paid tax and if you have taken the credit, then refund, ideally you should be eligible to take the refund of the wrongly paid tax, but taking suo motu credit amounts to refund. So that the argument needs to be taken for the, if there is a dispute in this with regard to the ITC. Because once you are not a recipient, then ITC cannot be taken. So that ground department will take. If you rely on the judgment that if you are saying that ocean freight is not payable, then they will say that ITC is also not available because you are not the recipient. But according to me, it has to be fought on ground that wrongly paid tax, I am eligible to refund, and by taking a suo motu credit, this amounts to refund money. So that grounds have to be taken. In that case, there will be. Secondly, if ITC is not availed only, if you are not availed the ITC, then whether refund can be taken? Answer is yes, but again, this will be subject to unjust enrichment. That if you have imbibed this cost of the IGST in your goods, you record from the customers, then in that case, you have to prove to the department that there is no unjust enrichment. The department will always ask that whether unjust condition has been fulfilled. So that refund will be subject to unjust enrichment. Secondly, a lot of people are asking a question that whether this judgment of the Gujarat High Court will be applicable to other states also. Suppose whether can I'm a RCC in Mumbai, whether I can take the rely on this judgment. According to me, yes, you can rely on this judgment in Mumbai because this is judgment under the central law. Basically, the GST is a central law. States also have their own state GST law, but it is a model law which is applied in all states, and accordingly that judgment will equally apply unless the Bombay High Court gives a contradictory judgment. So the High Court of the jurisdiction gives a contradictory judgment, then in that case this will not apply. But still you can rely on this judgment, and it is a very reasoned judgment, very detailed judgment, it is a very good judgment. It is a very initial judgment. In initial state, such judgments are coming under GST. So all the counsels, especially who have argued this case, they have done it in a very fabulous manner. The way the arguments are put, and therefore it is a very reasoned judgment. And I would appreciate that such kind of judgments are being given. So it's a very good judgment. and everyone should basically go through this segment if time permits. Secondly is on the FOB contracts, the GST liability, FOB contracts, yes, will be covered. This will not be covered under this category, that is the non-recipient, non-taxable supplier, non-taxable recipient. It will be covered in the general category of the import of service. Because in FOB contracts, if there is an ocean freight from a foreign shipping line, then the normal import of service rules will apply. And in that case, as an importer is the person who is liable to pay the consideration. So it's the recipient. And therefore, in that case, reverse charge will equally apply. But CIF contracts, this judgment is there of Mohit Minerals. And a lot of other high courts also, this writ petition has been filed. And this judgment, this dispute is going on the service tax regime also. In service tax regime also, this is an ongoing dispute. And therefore, on a fact-to-fact cases, everyone should take a call what needs to be done. So these are about the three judgments I was talking about. These are important judgments. A lot of other judgments are also coming. Especially Gujarat High Court has been very proactive in giving GST-related judgments. And during this relaxation period, everyone should, if possible, go through those judgments, especially the Gujarat High Court. Lot of judgments on GST, who are enthusiastic about reading about GST, that you can go through these judgments. Now, certain emerging issues and challenges which everyone will face, I would like to discuss after the lockdown ends. First is with regard to the, I feel that once this lockdown ends and the economy settles, there might be something called as a corona relief cess, which the government may levy. Which will be equivalent to this Kerala flood cess. So Kerala, there was a flood and after that state government levied a Kerala flood cess. So for the intrastate transaction, basically the Kerala, whatever the transactions are there on that cess was levied. So there might be something called as a corona relief cess also, that is something I predict can the government can levy, but and therefore it is possible that on what categories of goods it will be levied, what will be the rate of this cess, etc., is subject to the government to decide. But there might be something called as a corona flood cess, and there might be issues related to this in future. Then the government is thinking about the rationalization of the GST rates, basically merging the 12% and 18% into one category. So certain categories the rate will reduce, and certain categories the rate will increase. So now in this case, there might be reduction in the rate of certain products, and therefore on a very large scale, the first kind of reduction was in 2017, when there was Gujarat election and a lot of rates of the products were reduced, and after that a lot of notices were issued, especially in the FMCG sector, automobile sector, builders also a lot of notices were issued recently for the anti-profit trading compliances. If there is a reduction in the rate of GST on the products, then we should be careful with regard to the anti-profit trading compliances, because that benefit of the reduction in rate has to be passed on to the consumers. And there are a lot of orders of the National Anti-Profit Trading Authority, wherein a lot of issues are coming up, that there are a single product, suppose the shampoo is there. Shampoo, there are different SKUs, small sachet shampoo, 5 rupees shampoo, 10 rupees, 100 rupees. So what the company did, they reduced the rate in 100 rupees. Now they cannot reduce the rate in 1 rupee. The National Anti-Profit Trading Authority said that that has to be done SKU at SKU level, and not only one particular SKU. For all SKUs you have to do. Good that you have done in one SKU, but other SKUs also you have to do. So whatever is the profited amount with regard to the other SKU, deposit in the consumer. So this kind of challenges also will come up, and we need to be careful about the if there is some reduction in the rate of GST, then such kind of notices might start coming, because they want the benefit to pass on to the customers. The second thing with regard to anti-profit trading can be a challenge will be regard to inclusion of the petroleum products in GST. A lot of petroleum products, they are considering that the 5 petroleum products which are outside the GST net, they're considering of including the same in the GST. So a lot of ITC benefit will now be available. And therefore, if there is a benefit of ITC, then again that has to be passed on to the customers. That also anti-profiteering provisions has to be seen whenever this happens. And I think it will be very quick in the next 3 months. These two actions, that is reduction in the rate of tax, some products increase, some product decrease, and this inclusion of petroleum products. I think certainly they will do it in the quickly. They will do this, and we have to be careful with regard to the anti-profiteering as well as if you are MRP based products, your clients are dealing in MRP based products, then the compliance in the Legal Metrology Act also has to be seen. So all those things basically have to be taken into consideration. Then due to this outbreak and the impact on the economy, lot of contracts also might get cancelled. There might be some compensation payable for the cancellation of the contracts. Now, whether what will be the GST implications on this cancellation or the compensation? Compensation payable or cancellation of contract. That is one of the emerging area. I feel after the outbreak, people might experience that if contracts are being cancelled and some compensation is payable, then what are the GST implications on this compensation? Because there is an entry that tolerating an act, tolerating the obligation, agreeing to the obligation to tolerate an act, to an act, etc. And department fits everything in this category, all these kind of compensation penalties, etc. But this category. So this is one area which everyone needs to see. And there is one recent judgment of the Bombay High Court in Bhai Mahubhai Trust, wherein this concept of compensation penalties, etc. has been very beautifully discussed. And it's a very favorable judgment. And I would request people who are enthusiastic about GST may go through this judgment. I have given the citation. Broadly, whatever is my view on this is that there are two things. Compensation is for the breach of the contract, and consideration is for the performance of the contract. If the consideration is received, if it is for the performance of the contract, then GST is applicable. If anything which is for the compensation is for the breach of contract, is the nature of damages. There is no supply per se, there is no reciprocity per se. Therefore, broadly, GST should not apply. World over, this concept has been adopted. In European countries, especially Australia, New Zealand, etc., this concept has been adopted. That anything which is for the compensation for the breach of contract, that is not subject to GST. Consideration is for performance of the contract. So that kind of distinction has to be made. Secondly, with regard to the challenge which people will face is with regard to the non-realization of export proceeds. So this condition of the realization of export proceeds within 1 year, this is now applicable to goods also. But in the world economy, there is a lot of recession going on, and there might be non-realization of the export proceeds. So in this case, we should analyze what are the areas where we are not realizing, and as consultants or as auditors, we should opine our client that there will be implications with regard to the GST refunds also, and also with regard to the bad debts, which may be there with regard to the domestic transactions also. How to consult them with regard to this? That also needs to be seen. Next is non-payment of consideration within 180 days. This is also very pain area, because a lot of we will not be making payment within this time limit, because there will be cash crunch or cash flow issues with us also as a supplier and suppliers. In that case also, reversal of ITC is required. So again, in that case, this reversal of ITC provision, that will be a challenge. Secondly, there is something called as reversal of common ITC under Rule 42-43. Basically, whatever ITC is related, common ITC is related to the exempt as well as taxable products, and that reversal has to be done under Section 40, Rule 42 and 43. So basically, whenever this reversal is done, people normally, there are March end targets, and therefore these March end targets basically play a crucial role, because the turnover of the taxable product basically is dependent on the March end targets. And in some industries, this is a very important phenomenon, because they have to, provisional basis, monthly basis, they have to do the reversal, but yearly basis, they have to do at the end of June. But since this, because of this COVID-19 situation, there might be March end target which are missed out, and therefore this entire ratio of reversal of IT standard 42 and 43 will go for a toss, and therefore that evaluation has to be done on this common ITC also. That is also one area which we as professionals should see and guide our clients that this impact also will be there because of this COVID-19 situation. So these are some of the emerging issues and challenges which I think we all will face during once this lockdown ends or during this period. It will be very crucial for us to take into consideration all these facts, and therefore that is what I wanted to cover in this webinar. Now I will take up the questions. If anyone has any questions, then they can ask those questions. I will be happy to answer to the best of my abilities. Post the questions in the chat box if you have any questions. Any questions have been received? I think I just checked. I think interest question.
What question is received?
Yes, interest. No, interest. Interest I already answered.
Yeah.
Whether interest shall apply for reversal done in the month of September, with regard to that cumulative effect giving under Rule 36(4). That I have already answered. Any other question if people have, then they can raise. We have some 5-7 minutes. To wind this webinar. So if anyone has any question, then I'll be happy to answer. Anyone is anyone asking any question, then we can wind up. I think Hitesh bhai,
hello.
Yes, Hitesh bhai, I don't think anyone has any question. Everyone has understood. Thanks. Everything I think everyone either has understood everything or understood nothing, but I feel that I have tried to cover whatever was the recent amendments or development which have taken place. And thank everyone for the patient hearing. Also thank the association for giving me this opportunity to share my views on this development. Thank you everyone. Now Hitesh bhai, over to Hitesh bhai.
Yeah, thanks Raj for a wonderful session, and at a very short time you have covered a lot of things. As Raj told, we need to be geared up by June 30th with all full swing. So we all should be now be preparing for June 30th before the department start questioning, and not to wait for any extension. And thanks for everyone for having given us the opportunity. Thanks Raj also to take this session at a very short time, and thanks all of them to attend. A pleasant. Thank you. Thank you.